Hi there, and welcome to this lecture on process flow diagrams, simple control loops. My name is Marina Miletic. In the previous lecture, we learned that process equipment is not one size fits all and cannot arbitrarily adjust to any flow rate. Equipment is custom made for specific flow rates, temperatures, and pressures, which means while equipment can accommodate some variations, it cannot accommodate any flow rate, temperature, pressure, or concentration, and produce the same products, which is why it's so important to control flow rate throughout the process. So let's look at an example. Looking at this process, how would you control the flow rate of the main product stream so that you're producing about 58,670 kilograms per hour consistently? Take a moment and think about how you would achieve this. So let's say I decide to put a flow meter here to measure the flow rate of this stream, and I decide to send the signal to a flow indicator controller, which processes the signal and varies the flow rate of oxygen or ethylene all the way at the beginning of the process. Can you see anything wrong with doing this? What kinds of problems might occur with a control loop like this? One of the main issues here is that it most likely takes 30 to 120 minutes or more for a component to enter the process at the very beginning and make its way all the way through to the exit. This means that if flow rate at the exit is too low or high, the signal is already 30 to 120 minutes too late. This control loop's dead time is just too large. Something else to keep in mind is that there could be many other problems that cause there to be a low or high flow rate at the exit. The reactor could be running at the wrong temperature. A heat exchanger could be encountering a problem and not heating or cooling a stream properly. Essentially, it could be caused by a problem occurring in any one of these 12 pieces of equipment. And increasing or decreasing the flow rate here or here will not help. As a general rule, minimize the dead time and lag time for a feedback control loop. Also, don't make adjustments to streams or pieces of equipment if they're not directly related to the variable you're trying to control. With that in mind, think for a moment about how you would design an effective control loop to ensure more consistent flow rates throughout this process. You should think about measuring the flow rate of these inlet streams immediately before the compressors, sending the signal to a flow rate indicator controller, which then varies the flow rate of reactants coming out of the tanks which are storing them. This is one of the best ways of ensuring predictable product flow rates. Notice these loops are short, the dead time is minimized, and the flow rate control is directly related to a source of raw materials that can be independently varied. Now consider adding this control loop here on the recycle stream coming from the top of tower T101. Is this necessary, and what might go wrong if you add this additional loop onto the recycle stream? Because these two streams are almost the same composition, adding this additional control loop for the recycle stream is unnecessary. This is because if the flow rate coming from this distillation column is too high, you can just lower the flow rate of ethylene coming from the storage supply. If the flow rate coming from the column is too low, you can increase the flow of fresh ethylene coming into the process. So be sure not to over-design a control loop. Make sure you always control the minimum number of variables as possible while still maintaining adequate control of the process. There's also another reason not to have a control valve on this recycle stream. You should always avoid trying to control the flow rate of a process stream in the middle of a process, because this can cause streams to be diverted. For example, trying to control the distillate flow coming from this distillation column will alter the bottom's flow of the column, which will affect the flow rate going into T102, which will change the flow rate and concentration of these final streams. Except for the case of level control, flow control valves should be placed on streams that come from some independent supply, such as fresh feed or utility, such as cooling water or steam. Always make sure that flow is controlled by using a supply that can be increased or decreased independently. If you must put a control valve on a process stream, try to make sure it's at the very beginning or end of the process, or it's on a vessel controlling liquid level. In the next lecture, we'll look at combining two types of controllers and using multiple controllers for the same piece of equipment. Thanks for watching.